Thank you. Thank you, Bruce. Is this on? It is. I don't think it is. No? Yeah, it's good. Thank you. First of all, I very much doubt was my wife. And secondly, my book was the exception to the rule. When I mentioned to Jonathan Biggins that tonight I'd be talking about chefs, Jonathan looked puzzled and said, could chefs be part of the creative community? And I said, well, they certainly think so. It raises the great question that chefs often ask themselves when they sort of sit around at night, you know, pondering the deeper meaning of life. Is food art? Well, then if it is, it's the only art we consume and excrete. Now, I'm going to call this talk Dots, Dashes and Degustations, the Dictatorship of the Chef. Now, I'm assuming that you've all eaten at restaurants, and I'm assuming you've all eaten at rather good restaurants and rather pretentious restaurants. So let's get stuck into some of these people. Dots, Dashes, Degustations, the Dictatorship of the Chef, or rather, as he or she is called in their kingdom, chef, as in yes chef, no chef. Let's start with what we call what is called in chef talk plating. Any of you who have eaten in a restaurant with any pretension to modernity have been served a plate covered with little dots, dashes and squiggles of coloured stuff. I don't get it. And I usually don't get it, the plate that is, until what's on it is no longer hot. And I don't mean cool. In places that perform this kind of culinary cuteness, you'll see five baby chefs in a row at the pass, where the food comes out, adding the bits and bobs to the plate. Only when chef, that's head chef, deems it good looking enough does it get to the table. Who cares if it's cold? It's art. And what do you get with these? What do you do with these little splashes of caramelised foie gras or vanilla and olive oil syrup or celeriac jus? There's never enough to actually eat. And funnily enough, that's what I'm there to do, eat. But that's only one aspect of what the great Spanish food writer Javier Domingo called the curse of creative cuisine. Served at the kind of restaurant where the, have you been to one of these, where the waiter stands over your shoulder and tells you how to eat the dish. First, monsieur, you'll raise the spoon to your mouth. Now put it in, but don't swallow. Pick up a little glass and put that in your mouth too. Swill them together. And where do they get these insane, inane instructions come from? Yes, chef, please go away. I know how to eat. I have been doing it for some time. And in a dictator-led restaurant, you'll never get a dish cooked the same way. You'll never get the dish cooked the way you remember it. It'll be the chef's version. So instead of coq au vin, you get coq au vin chef. Instead of boring old filet mignon, you'll get filet magnum covered in chocolate. If you complain about it, you'll be told, that's the way a chef does it. And that's it, no arguing with chef. The person we have to blame most recently for all this faddish food fiddling and kitchen tyranny is Spanish super chef Ferran Adrià in his world-famous restaurant El Bulli. More people worked there than ate there, which was curious. He served things like carrot LYO foam with hazelnut foam air and Cordoba spices. It might be Senor Adrià invented foam. Now, the problem I have with all this stuff is I'm never sure what I'm eating. What is carrot LYO foam? Barry spoke about art that has to be explained. Is it even worse when something as basic, as simple as something, stuff you put in your mouth has to be explained? The creative cuisine that Adrià and his fellow despot Heston Blumenthal dictated to the world spread through Australia like wild foam. Master chef's George Columbaris, you might not know, was an early acolyte. His restaurant Reserve in Melbourne served dishes like chocolate and blue cheese, seared bitter chocolate ganache, roast hazelnut vinaigrette, blue cheese sauce, and beef and ice cream. Sugar-cured braised beef, croquette style, studded with bone marrow, seeded mustard mash, brown onion ice cream. Reserve opened in 2003. George got the Young Chef of the Year award in 2004, and Reserve closed in 2005. Bar boom! George now has a terrific restaurant in Melbourne serving traditional Greek food, and he isn't there much because he's on television. And that's another problem with modern food. Chef in name only, or rather, executive chef. What a weasel. Chef doesn't actually cook anymore. And then there's the problem with anything creative. Very few people are up to it. But everyone wants to be super chef, celebrity chef, dictator chef. So you often find this kind of culinary mishmash on menus. Risotto of Japanese scallops and fresh herbs with a green curry coconut sauce. Or our own sun-dried tomato fettuccine, feta, olives and Asian vegetables in aroma tomato sauce. Now, I didn't make that up. Somebody who should have known better did. Now, one of my favourites is the let's make it taste like something else school. Chef doesn't like the way the produce tastes, so he changes it. I recently went to a dinner which was supposed to be showcasing the superb seafood caught by a fisherman called Mark Ether. Mark uses only hand lines, and he kills using the Japanese Ikijime system, where the fish gets a spike in the brain, dies instantly, and tastes a lot better. Mark's fish sell for a premium here and in Japan. And he especially loves a fish called the Tasmanian striped trumpeter, which he reckons to be one of the best tasting fish on the planet. Well, I don't know, because the chef that cooked it that night served a dish called line caught trumpeter, roasted chicken flavour. I mean, you had to admire him. He did manage to make what just might be the best tasting fish on the planet taste like roast chicken. The other problem with this kind of cooking is it's like stepping into a river. It's never the same twice. You go back to the restaurant the next week and you say, can I have that terrific dish I had last week? And the waiter looks at you scathingly, and waiters go to scathing school, and he says, chef doesn't do it anymore. That was so last week. And then there's a dreaded degustation. Oh, like water torture with food. You know the deal. You sit down and you are the prisoner of the man in the white coat. The mildest mannered chef becomes a camp commandant when he's serving a degustation. You will eat exactly what I want you to eat, one tiny plate at a time, and you will not finish until I am finished with you. Do you understand? 3 hours and 14 dishes later, when you are stuffed, literally and metaphorically, you are free to leave. It's like a gastronomic Guantanamo Bay. Food, of course, is fashion, and fashion comes and goes. You remember the stack? Food piled up on the plate? The old joke at the time was, what's the difference between Sydney and Melbourne? About 6 centimetres. The other thing that goes up and down like hemlines is the length of the names of dishes on the menu. I remember dishes with names nearly as long as the list of ingredients on the back of a shampoo bottle. This one, for example, sashimi of corner inlet rock flathead, Tasmanian trumpeter, salt-cured white wild oyster cream, black-lipped abalone, raw sea cabbage, green radish, nasturtiums, warrigals and periwinkles. That's not a dish, it's a shopping list. That fashion is changing, if it hasn't already changed. At fashionable Sydney Inner Bistro Oscillate Wildly, they have oscillated wildly the other way. On their menu, you will find a dish called pine curd needles. Now, considering they're in Newtown, what kind of needles might they be? And does the pine come as a whole tree or just pinocline jus? Then there's pandan, rye and milk. And this is from the degustation menu I love. Cheese on toast. Considering the $10 supplement, I'm guessing it's not sliced coon on Tip Top. Could this mealtime minimalism be the new trend? Sydney Morning Herald's Terry Durack recently began a review of a new restaurant called Kitchen by Mike with these words. So it has come to this. Sydney-siders queuing for food, doled out on enamel tin plates and eaten at bare communal tables. It gets worse. It's annoying to queue for a confit, onion, tomato jam and anchovy tartine, only to see the last one snaffled by some clearly underserving soul ahead of you. You can see where this is heading, can't you? Especially if you're a Seinfeld fan. No tartine for you! Go to the back of the queue! Now, where will the dictatorship of the chef end? Will there be dormant like they have at nightclubs, and we'll be vetted as to whether we're cool enough to eat chef's food? In the future, will chefs do seasons in restaurants like actors in the theatre or entertainers? We've already seen Jamie Oliver, Ferran Adrià and Hester Blumenthal on stage. Would you go to a theatre to see a chef talk? It's our fault. Well, the critics, that is. We have become handmaidens to these new celebrities. We've created monsters. The cult of personality has turned the tables. Do Australia's chefs take themselves too seriously? I'll leave the last word to one of our great chefs and restaurateurs, Gay Bilson. When Gay was closing Barara Waters, a truly great restaurant whose fame had spread across the globe, there was a wailing and a gnashing of teeth from the scribes. Ms. Bilson's response was simple, succinct, and spot on. It's only a bloody restaurant. And as much as I know food is important, and I know it's important to have wonderful places to eat and brilliant chefs cooking in them, it's only bloody food. And most definitely, some of our chefs take themselves too bloody seriously. Thank you.